Last time I started anaerobic non-spore forming gram-negative bacilli and gave the general overview for the chapter. And this time I will go to the individual genus. And this time Diclobacter, this is one of the genus having a gram-negative non-spore forming bacteria. And this genus is having only a single species, Diclobacter nodosus. And Diclobacter nodosus, it belongs to Cardiobacteriaceae family. The family name is Cardiobacteriaceae. And earlier it belonged to Bacteroides genus. And earlier it was known as Bacteroides nodosus. And also Fusiformis nodosus. But now it is separated from the Bacteroides and became a separate family known as Cardiobacteriaceae family, and the only genus is Diclobacter and the species is Diclobacter nodosus. And this is the primary etiological agent of the foot rot in the case of sheep and goat. Also, it causes disease in other animals, but the primary cause is in sheep and goat. As earlier told, it's a gram-negative bacteria. And it is having a shape of a straight or slightly curved rod. And in smear, it shows the terminal swelling. On the both terminals, it shows the swelling due to which it gives the appearance of dumbbell. And when it is subcultured in the broth and then again staining is done, then this feature seems less. And the colony characteristic, as told, it's required. It is a fastidious organism and requires the blood agar and along with the some other supplements is required. And for the Diclobacter, sometimes powder of hoof is also required to promote the growth. And the colony will be smooth, convex, or translucent or semi-opaque. And sometimes the colony are inside the just beneath the agar surface and it gives a shrunken appearance. And three types of the colony are produced based on the virulence of the isolate. Depending upon the virulence of the isolate, the colony characteristics are different. And three types of the colonies are seen, known as papillate or beaded type, which is known as in short beef type. Another one is mucoid type, M type, and another one is the circular type. And depending upon the virulence of the isolate, these different colonies types are seen. So if the culture is done from the fresh isolates of the advanced foot rot condition, then the papillated or beaded type of the colonies will be seen. And whereas if the non-invasive yes. infection is there and only the isolate is causing the interdigital infection or interdigital dermatitis, which is comparatively less pathogenic, then the colony will be of mucoid nature. Whereas if the culture is subcultured in the liquid medium again and again, and so the culture will turn into a virulent type and the colony seen will be of circular type. And this bacteria is non-flagellated. Flagella is responsible for the motility. But in this bacteria, flagella yes. is not there. Then too, it is motile by the virtue of typhorphimbrin. Typhorphimbrin is present. And this is responsible for causing the twitching motility. Typhorphimbrin, it is a... What is fimbri? It is a long, thin appendages. And it's a filamentous type of structure. And type 4 fimbri, mostly in the gram-negative bacteria, those in presently some gram-positive bacteria are also reported to have type 4 fimbri. But it is mainly in the gram-negative bacteria in which type 4 fimbri is present. And it is related with the twitching movement of the bacteria. And it causes the one time you can say it's a crawling movement or flagella will what it is a flagella independent motility. What will be to By extension and retraction of the pilot, the movement is done. So the in this femoral, it is responsible for the motility and it's responsible for the virulence of the bacteria, because the due to the presence of type 4 femoral, it can move to the deeper part of the tissue and get the anaerobic condition, and so the lesion produced will be more. And its protein is highly immunogenic, and on the basis of this protein only, the serotyping of traditional serotyping of D nodosus is done. And coming to its biochemical characters, it is oxidase and catalase negative, and also the indole and urease test are negative, whereas it gives positive test with H2S, and it does not ferment any carbohydrate. And virulence factors, this bacteria is having a wide range of the virulence, and the virulence is categorized as virulent, intermediate, and the benign type. Means based on the severity, the virulence is of a virulent nature, virulent, benign, or intermediate. And the what are the virulence factor? Proteases and the twitching movement, means the type 4, presence of the type 4 fimbriae. These are the virulence factors. What is the virulence factors? Any idea? Virulence factor, what is the
Yes, ma'am. Its capacity of pathogenesis, pathogenetic capacity.
Presence of certain structure or the biochemical products or the genetic structure,
yes,
of the bacteria, which gives the virulence,
yes,
capacity to produce the disease. Pathogenicity.
Yes,
it imparts pathogenicity,
yes,
to the bacteria. So,
yes,
and there are also certain genes like INT gene and the VRL genes, which are associated with the virulence, but these are not the virulence factor, but the have a regulatory role in the expression of the virulence genes. And the, so first virulence factor is fimbriae, type 4 fimbriae, and it is mainly responsible for the adherence to the epithelial surface of the bacteria with the host cells. And also it is responsible for the translocation of the organism from the epidermis to the deeper tissue by the twitching movement. And so the it is required for the bacterial growth and the extracellular protease production, and ultimately leading to the lesion formation. And so the twitching movement and the production of the protease, protease is another virulence factor present in this Dicrobacter nodosus. These two are the responsible for the virulence of the bacteria. And as this is a gram-negative bacteria, so it will be having a cell wall structure which is similar to the other gram-negative bacteria. And the LPS will be of the similar nature as the other gram-negative bacteria, but in the LPS content is virulent, and another content is outer membrane protein which promotes the adherence to the host cell surface, and it interferes with the host immune responses, and it is highly antigenic and having phage variant. Phage variant means the outer membrane protein is outer membrane protein, it is a combination of the four different types of the genes which are interrelated, and the when the immune system it gets the attack of the immune system, the phase variation occurs, means the it can switch from the one gene product gene form to another gene form, and different type of the protein can be generated, encoded. OMP1, ABCD. OMP is the outer membrane protein 1. And it is of ABCD, four types of the protein are there. And it is a variant form. These four variants are responsible for the secretion, encoding of the outer membrane protein. But the accordingly, when it get the immune attack, then it can undergo antigenic shift from the one form to the another form. And serine protease, this is a protease produced by the bacteria, and it is a important virulence factor, and it is responsible for the protease. What it does, protease means it can degrade the protease structure.
Yes, ma'am.
So it is responsible for the tissue damage. Main tissue damage of the bacteria of the host, it is caused by the production of the proteases. And three types of the proteases are produced by the bacteria, and all the three types are structurally similar. But depending upon the virulence, presence of the proteases, virulence of the bacteria is decided. High virulent strain produces acidic proteases. Two types of acidic proteases are produced, and one basic protease is produced. And the presence of the acidic proteases is essential for the virulence. It means the bacteria which is not producing the acidic proteases, that will be less virulent or will be not virulent. And some are the combination of the acidic and basic proteases. And when the combination of acidic and the basic proteases there, then the benign lesions will be produced. Means it will be of mild virulent nature. And so the difference of the amino acid sequence of in the proteases is responsible for the variation in the virulence of the different strains. And these protease genes are located on the pathogenicity island. What is the pathogenicity island? It's a cluster of genes, or you can say a collection of the genes which may be present on the chromosome, or it may be present on the plasmid. And many a times it is present on the plasmid. So it can transmit from the one bacteria to another bacteria as along with the these type of the genes on pathogenicity island. Other mobile gene segments are also present. Mobile gene segments, you have learned, jumping genes or mobile genes, which can be transmitted from the another
bacteria. One location to another. Yes, ma'am.
Gene transfer. Just through the conjugation or through the plasmid, means through the bacteria.
Yes, ma'am.
A cluster of the genes can be transferred from the one bacteria to the another bacteria. So these protease genes are located on the pathogenicity island. Pathogenicity island means a cluster of gene or structure of the gene segment which may be present on the chromosome, or it may be present on the plasmid. So means it's not a part of the chromosome of the bacteria. Genome part, it's not a genome part, but it is a separate specific structure present on the chromosome, or it may be present on the plasmid. Growth characteristics, already told, it's an anaerobic bacteria, so anaerobic condition will be required for the growth. And but apart from the anaerobic condition, it also requires the carbon dioxide, and it is a fastidious organism, so it require a rich medium. Already in the previous class, growth conditions is given. It require protein like in the form of hoof tissue. It can be given to the growth medium for its growth. And it is a slow growth. It requires generally in the 2 days you can see the growth on the culture, but it requires at least 4 to 5 days of incubation to see the small colonies of this bacteria. And resistant, although it is known as anaerobic bacteria, but already I have told that this bacteria is highly aerotolerant. All the pathogenic anaerobic bacteria are aerotolerant and can survive the plates exposed to the air up to the 10 days. So the it doesn't not that the it is anaerobic bacteria, then it will not grow in the aerobic condition. As it produces oxidase dismutase, which is responsible for the tolerance of the bacteria in the aerobic condition, and it also survives in the environment for the 2 to 3 days. But it is susceptible to the many disinfectants and antibiotics, and it can survive and can be transmitted via soil to the other host. And it in the subclinical infection of interdigital skin or in the hoof lesion, it can survive for the longs months. And variability, polyvariability, as I told, the presence of the fimbriae and the proteolytic activity due to the protease, presence of the protease, type of the protease is responsible for the strains variation, whether it will be benign strain or intermediate strains or the virulent strains. And the proteases, nature of the proteases, it declares that whether the strain will be virulent or the benign or intermediate. And on the basis of all the antigenic constitution of the fimbrial adhesion, these groups, these bacteria is divided into 10 serogroups, A to I and M. And again, all these 10 serogroups are classified into two different major classes. And the one class one is, it includes the serogroup 1C, E to G, I and M, which is having few. Whereas class 2 genes group includes the serogroup D and H, and apart from FIM A, it mainly contains FIM A gene, and apart from the FIM A, other 3 genes are called FIM D, FIM D and FIM Z. And nature of the these 3 FIM C, D and Z genes are not known, they are unknown of nature, but the presence is seen in the in class 2 type of the D-nodosus group. Yes. And the reservoir, infected foot of the sheep and goat, which is mainly affected by this bacteria, acts as a reservoir. And also the cattle are get affected, but these are of the low virulence. And transmission by direct or indirect contact, and sometimes it also survive in the environment. So the, if the bacteria is present in the bedding material and the in the environment, and if get the susceptible host, then also infection occurs to the other host. And the pathogenesis, it is due to the fimbriae, presence of the fimbriae, which helps in the adherence and also the translocation of the bacteria to the deeper anaerobic tissue. And a protease enzyme, which is having the proteolytic activity, and also the it is having synergism effect with the Fusobacterium necrophorum, which causes the tissue damage, and it provides the growth factor. D-nodosus provides the growth factor, and the Fusobacterium necrophorum causes the tissue damage. And the tissue damage is favorable condition for the growth of the D-nodosus. So both bacteria having beneficial effect for each other. And so it promotes the both the bacteria growth. So whenever there is an infection of D-nodosus, then Fusobacterium infection may also be there. And so the generally in the foot rot condition, infection is also present. The primary cause is Helicobacter nodosus. And the disease condition is a foot rot, and which is a inflammatory condition of the tissue is seen. If the dermal tissue necrosis occurs, and 3 forms of the disease is seen, which is virulent, intermediate, and benign. If the based on the severity of the lesions, the condition will be virulent or intermediate. Means the intermediate means it is having a wide range. Means sometimes the symptoms may be seen like a virulent type, sometimes the symptoms like the virulent. So it will be of intermediate type. And the benign type, the lesion will be not the very severe, and the only the lesion will be the interdigital dermatitis type. So, and the virulence means
yes.
the severity will be more, and it is told that if the degree of motility of the strain is more, then the lesion produced will be of a severe type. And the virulence will depend upon the population type, whether the strain is benign virulent type of, and also the environmental factor. If the bacteria is already present to the dam or to the bedding material, then the host will be more susceptible for the disease condition. And the virulent form will be characterized by the severe lesions, yeah, and it will cause the destruction of the horn of the hoof, and the erosion of the tissue will be done, and it is highly contagious, and will be having significant impact on the productivity because of the severe damage. The animal will become lame, and the lameness will be the region, and so the productivity of the animal will also be affected. And intermediate type, the range of the disease syndrome will be seen. As told that sometimes the lesions will appear that the lesion is of severe nature. Sometimes it will appear that the lesion is of mild type. And the benign type form is a disease of a milder nature. And only it causes the interdigital skin lesions with the dermatitis. And this condition is also called as food scald. And this condition, underlying tissue will not be damaged and delamination will not be seen. And how the foot rot condition develops? First of all, this condition, foot rot condition, is generally in damp area or the area where the heavy waterfall occurs, this condition occurs. So the persistent soaking of the hoof will be there. The foot will be there, and in soil, Fusobacterium necrophorum is a bacteria which is also an anaerobic bacteria, is present, and it causes that infect the damaged tissue and causes the superficial lesions. If skin lesion is done by the Fusobacterium necrophorum, then it makes the condition favorable for the colonization of the Diplobacter nodosus, and with the aid of the fimbriae, it attaches to the tissue and proliferates in the lesions, which is initiated by the Fusobacterium necrophorum, and so it will produce the interdigital swelling. And again, the expansion of the epidermal tissue occurs with the help of the secreted protease, because the Diplobacter nodosus produces the proteases, and which is responsible for the further damage of the tissue. And so deeper tissue will be invaded by the bacteria, and if there is secondary bacterial infection also there, then it will further complicate the situation. And if the damage is more and it involves the two or more feet, then the extreme lameness will be there in the host, and the animal will become immobilized. And disease is mainly responsible for the infection of the teeth and gut, but sometimes the foot lesions are also reported in horse, pigs, cattle, deer, etc. And it is present in all continents, but the severe disease condition will be seen with the areas where the climate is mild and having abundant rainfall. And if the temperature falls below the 50 degrees Fahrenheit or 10 degrees centigrade, then the bacterial dissemination ceases. And generally in the dry period, the disease condition will not be severe, and conditions improve in the dry period. And all the animals beyond the nursing age stages are susceptible for the disease condition. But this disease condition severity varies with the genetic makeup of the animal also, and generally the fine wool breeds are the more susceptible for the disease conditions. And also this bacteria is present in the contaminated pastures, but this cannot survive for the long time in the pasture, and so it will be eliminated from the contaminated pasture within 2 weeks. So short period survival is there in the environment. Coming to its diagnosis, generally this disease condition is diagnosed based on the seeing the clinical symptoms, and the direct smear from the foot lesion is done with the negative staining, and it reveals that the presence of rod which is having terminal swellings. Then this condition, based on the symptoms and lesions and the staining, in this condition it can be diagnosed. Generally, culture-based diagnosis is not done regularly because it is a fastidious organism and requires a special media for the growth. And also, it is a slow growth, having a slow growth. So, in that time, treatment cannot be stopped. So, based on the lesion seen and the tentative diagnosis, treatment can be started. And it also requires a selective media, and sometimes the powdered hoof, ovine hoof is added to promote the, enhance the growth. And pathogenicity can be detected by elastase activities and gelatin gel test for the protease activities. And also ELISA is, can be done using the monoclonal antibodies against the proteases and other antibodies. And this bacteria can also be diagnosed based on the PCR, which can target some specific pathogenic genes and also the nucleic acid probe. And this disease do not produce any type of the immunity. Even the recently recovered animals are susceptible for the reinfection. So it is also better to avoid the infections. Animal is recovered from the host, then also it will be susceptible for the another infections. And coming to the treatment, this treatment starts with the removal or exposure of the disease tissue by the hoof trimming, which is also known as foot paring. And the, then trimming is done, and then topical application of the disinfectant or the antibiotic or the combination of both is done. Like 5 to 10% formalin, 5% copper sulfate or zinc sulfate or tetracycline tincture can be used for the topical applications. And foot bath is also given to the animal. And on formalin, copper sulfate and zinc sulfate can be used for the foot bath. And reports have shown that the 3-1 hour 20% zinc sulfate foot bath at weekly interval is having a beneficial effect even without the foot pairing. So the if for 1 hour 20% zinc sulfate foot soaking is done three times at a weekly interval, then it can prevent the foot cure the foot rot condition. And a high dose of the penicillin and the streptomycin is done given systematically. If the topical application is not given, then too this treatment will be beneficial and will cure the condition. And in some countries, vaccine is also available, and the generally it is extensively used in the sheep producing countries like Australia and New Zealand. These countries are following the vaccines, and these vaccines are an integral part of the eradication program. And vaccine not only the prevent the appearance of the disease, but it is also shown to have some therapeutic effect in the accelerating healing condition. Even if the people have suffered with the disease, and so that it will help in the healing of the wound. And these vaccines are based on the fimbriel protein, because these fimbriel protein are having immunogenic effect, and so the vaccine contains 8 to 10 strains of the common serogroups which are present locally to the area. And coming to the control, it will be a combined effect means the repeated examination of the animal, whether the animal is suffering with the disease or not, and vaccination, proper vaccination of the animal should be done. Treatment of the active cases, if any animal is suffering with the disease, then that animal should be isolated from the rest of the herd, and it should be properly cleared, and treatment should be done. And avoid the adding infected animal to the flock. If any animal is having infection, then it should be kept separately from the rest of the herd and should not be mixed with the other flock members. And the contaminated lot should not be restocked for the 2 weeks. Also, the contaminated bedding material should be changed, and because the bacteria may be present in the environment, because fecal dissemination of the bacteria also occurs, and it may contaminate to the bedding material where it may be present. And many research has shown that on the contaminated bedding material, even the newborn lambs, they can get bacteria in their food, even though they were not infected by the birth. So the contaminated lot should not be restocked for the 2 weeks. And generally, these control measures should be planned in the dry period of the year, before the commencement of the rainy season. Vaccination should be done, and everything should be done, and all the control measures should be adopted, so that in the rainy season, they should floor should not be damp, and it should prevent the infection to the flock. So this all about the Diclobacter nodosus. इसको पढ़ो
जी मैम.